I appointed Sandy as the chairman of it, and she has a reputation for digging deep into these subjects and does it quite well, you know, and obviously she does very well at that because you're here.
Well, she's persuasive. You don't know about her research skills, but her sales skills are pretty good. Maybe it's like a speech fire.
No, your reputation precedes you, you know, so we're glad to have you here.
But what precipitated this, the study group?
Well, people have come to town, want to install solar installations on various pieces of property. I don't know how many people have been approached or whether they've signed any agreements.
So it was more of a reaction to the solicitation of property owners?
Yeah.
So the board believed that it was important to gather information to help the property owners make more informed decisions.
Absolutely.
Fair enough?
Yep.
Okay.
See you later.
Well, we'll see you later.
But tell us a little bit about what was on your board before you get started.
Okay, so first of all, I apologize, I've been up late. My day really didn't start all that well. Got in my car, I had to go to Syracuse this morning. So I got in my car, and because the temperatures overnight weren't like 75 degrees like they had been for the last week, the air pressure on all four of my tires was low. So while I thought I was going to be early for my appointment in Syracuse, I had first stop at Sunoco Station and filled the tires with air. Then I got out on 219, I live in Boston, New York. I got out on 219 and was going to punch in the number to call my assistant to leave her a message, and my cell phone's not working. Well, I immediately recognized that my cell phone wasn't in the car. And I had this long day ahead of me, and, you know, I mean, how do we exist without cell phones? From emails and texts to phone communication. So now I got to drive all the way back to Boston to go and find my phone on the ground, fortunately in the driveway of my house. So that's how my day started, and it's just kind of, you know, backed up ever since. So I apologize that I'm late. So I am Dennis Vacco. I'm a partner at the law firm of Lippis, Mathias, Wexler, Friedman. It's a long name. We are shortening it to call it Lippis Mathias. That's our logo. We're located in downtown Buffalo, where we are on the 17th floor of the Fountain Plaza, which is on the corner of Main and Chippewa. If you're going into Buffalo on 33 from the Thruway, you'll see our name, at least Lippis Mathias, on the top of the building. Mary Kate is in our marketing department, and she's gracious enough to join us here tonight to do the slideshow. Before I joined Lippis, kind of interesting, I've done a lot of things in life. 20 years as a prosecutor, I was assistant DA in Erie County for 10 years. President Reagan appointed me to be the United States Attorney for the Western District of New York, which includes Genesee County, back in 1988. So 29 years ago, I became the chief federal prosecutor for the 17 counties of Western New York. And then in 1994, I ran for the office of Attorney General in the state of New York, was elected in 1994 and defeated in 98, and went to the private sector for the first time in my career in 1999. I actually worked for Waste Management of Texas, so WMI. So I worked for a large national corporation for 5 years. So I took a step back from the law and from government, and ran a $750 million company. I was responsible for running the company's New York State assets. And then I went back to the law in Albany, and then eventually came back home to Buffalo and joined this wonderful law firm. We are a full-service law firm, mostly based, you know, our focus is mostly business-oriented, all things business, from corporate formations to mergers and acquisitions. We do a lot of real estate work, high-end real estate, We represent developers, we represent publicly traded corporations, large and small businesses. My practice group, which is a pretty robust practice group, brings a government investigations component to the table. So, you know, we represent doctors and nurses and companies, white collar individuals who have been accused of defrauding the government or, you know, defrauding their businesses. So it's a pretty robust practice group. We got into, so land use is part of the DNA of our firm. We have a very large real estate practice group. We do an awful lot of development work, so for developers. So we do, you know, brownfields, we do greenfields, we do, you know, big office buildings, we do condos, we do shopping malls all across the United States. So land use is in our DNA. But what is in my DNA is agriculture, because despite what I've told you about my professional career, my grandfather in 1940 started a farm that is now 77 years in business and still operating. My father, God bless him, 89 years old, is still the principal operator of the enterprise that I now own for estate planning purposes, but he still runs it. When I was a kid, before I even went to law school, we were much more robust. You know, we were the size of some of the big guys here in Genesee County, and, you know, calls, you know, some of the big growers, some of the big farmers here in Genesee County. We once had a cultivation, 2,500 acres of just snap peas. You know, we were pretty big in the snap pea business for processing. We're also very big in vineyards. We're one of Welch's largest growers. We have 375 acres of Concord grape vineyards that are contracted exclusively to Welch, and another, you know, 100 odd some odd number of acres contracted to another third-party laborer. So now we grow in the spring. We got to grow strawberries for fresh markets, and we grow corn all season long. We still have corn in the fields. We grow the best corn in most of New York, in my estimation. But now we still grow beans, but not 2,500 acres anymore, but more like 1,000 acres. And of course, our grapes, we just started our harvest, the grape harvest, and we're harvesting our pumpkins now. So we got a lot of things going on at the farm, and we own a lot of land. While we have under, you know, tillage, close to 2,000 acres between our vineyards and our cover crops and our beans, we probably own half of that. So, and we own it over a broad, you know, geographic spectrum in Cattaraugus County, Erie County, Southern Erie County, Wyoming County. So I come to this discussion from a variety of different angles. No, by the way, so one last piece of disclaimer here, just explanation, so you have an understanding of what helped frames my thoughts on these issues. 2 years ago, I was hired by the town of Somerset up in Niagara County, where they are in the process of evaluating a large-scale turbine project. And I'll talk about this in more detail in a moment or two. So we've been representing the town of Somerset. We also represent for another project up in Jefferson County in the town of Clayton. So if you've ever been to the Thousand Islands and, you know, the Thousand Island Bridge that takes you over into Canada, well, about 6 miles just to the west going toward the mouth of the St. Lawrence River is the village of Clayton, which is a lovely tourist town. So we represent the town of Clayton as they also battle a large-scale wind project. So, full disclosure, at least as it relates to those two projects, I am opposed to the construction of those projects. As I've said, and we've done this presentation, whether it's solar, although it's mostly been solar, a little tinge of wind. We've done this several times. We've actually teamed up. So Sandra, that's why it was easy to say yes to you, because we've done this many times in conjunction with the New York State Farm Bureau, because Cypress Creek, so who's the Cypress Creek rep here? Hi, how are you? So, you know, Cypress Creek, so your company will be prominently mentioned in my presentation, in part mostly because I received a solicitation from you guys. So as more and more solicitations were hitting the streets, you know, the Farm Bureau came to me and said, well, you know, would you be willing to do these presentations? So I'm about to get to the substance of this, but I wanted to make sure that you understood my background, that you understand, you know, what my thought process is to get to the advice and recommendations, or at least, you know, the overview that I'm going to give you here tonight. I'll conclude the overview by saying I am not anti-green energy. I mean, it's almost like saying that you're against mom and apple pie to say you're against anti-green energy. Nor am I in the pocket of the carbon industry. So I'm not here as a shield for you know, coal companies or oil companies. I'm here just, you know, as a guy who's got experience in a multiple of different facets of life and business and the law, who is going to try to hit the ball down the middle of the fairway here tonight. There are upsides and downsides, as you'll see as we go through the slide presentation, that I think you invited me here to talk about, so that you have a sense of what, you know, what are the good things and what are the bad things. And lastly, in full disclosure, one of your competitors is chasing me right now for a piece of land in the town of Concord. And
what company is that?
Frankly, I'm a little interested in it. I'll tell you the name of the company right now. It literally just sent me an email today. There it is. So, and I cite that only because in my presentation you'll see, I think at the end of the day, and I don't want to end with this, but I think, you know, when we get to the point in this conversation where we're winding down to the end and your questions, you'll see that it really kind of boils down to, at the end of the day, you know, the old real estate adage, location, location, location. Okay? This company is Solar Liberty. Solar Liberty. I think it's a Lackawanna-based company.
You think what?
I believe it's a Lackawanna, New York-based company, I think. I don't know why I say that, but the phone numbers are all 716 phone numbers. So, now you know who I am. Let's get this rolling. We'll get over this. So go back to this. So, Joe Hines typically joins me on these ventures because he is in our real estate practice group. So when we've done this before with the Farm Bureau, unfortunately Joe's got a, you know, he's got a family at home and he's a younger guy, so he's got to be home for kids tonight. But as you can see, I mean, this is just a sample. And by the way, he's not even a partner; he's an associate. But you can see how extensive his practice background is. You know, we have a lot. So in our real estate practice group, we have a lot of experience with utility leases, telecommunication. We do a lot of cell tower installations. I won't name the client for you, but we represent a large cell tower company. So we do work across many states in siting cell towers. Oh, by the way, we had a lease that we had with a cell tower company, and not too long ago, I monetized it by selling giving them a permanent easement. So I sold them a permanent easement. So I'm also, from a personal business perspective, you know, we got cell towers as well. But this is just a smattering of what we do in our real estate practice group. Next slide, please. We could go over that. We've talked about that. Keep going, please. Beth Perry, so another younger, so Beth is a partner. Also, as you can see, like me, farm girl, she grew up in Bliss, New York, which is in Wyoming County. And she is the head of our Trust and Estates Practice Group. She sometimes joins me on these ventures, but again, she's got a young one at home as well. Sometimes she joins me on these ventures because we do an awful lot of estate planning and succession planning for family businesses. Most, even today, most agricultural operations are still family, you know, family owned and operated. So from, you know, estate planning, protecting your assets, to succession planning, and this becomes relevant as you, as I get into the discussion about these leases, because these leases sometimes are for 20 plus years. At least the proposal is for these leases. In other words, the leases have the real ability of spanning generations, and you need to keep that in mind as you're doing your estate planning. Let's go. So I've told you a little bit about the firm. We've been in existence since 1965. You know, what I did leave off is that we have an office in Albany, one in Burlington, Ontario, and we are exploring opening an office right now as we speak in the state of Florida. So we are on a growth trajectory. We are 70 plus lawyers strong now in three locations regionally. Okay, solar lease in the overview. Let's go. I'm sorry, what is your name?
My name is John Reagan.
John Reagan. So do you mind if I call you John? Okay. So and part of what I think, I don't mean to speak for John or for Cypress Creek, but I think part of what has created a more robust environment around alternative energy, green energy, is Governor Cuomo's mandate that by 2030, 50% of the state's power shall be generated from alternative energy sources. In other words, green energy. So the governor set out this goal. And by the way, this I call it a mandate because it's now more than political rhetoric. It's more than just, you know, campaign rhetoric. It is state policy. Again, trying to hit the ball down the middle of the fairway, I'm a little skeptical about our ability to get here. So it's 50% by 2030. Well, by my math, that's about 12 years and 3 months away. To facilitate that, to go from where we are now, you know, the alternative energy generation right now, if you take into account water, which it mostly is Niagara Falls, there's probably, you know, close to 20% of the state's power is probably generated from water, but not from any other substantial alternative energy source. You have the, you know, the windmills there in Wyoming County, you have some windmills further east down the Thruway, turbines, but there's not enough in place. Let me put it this way. There's not enough alternative energy generation capacity today to get that 50%. So what happened is the governor pushed through the legislature an amendment to the public service law, public utilities law, Article 10, which was designed to streamline the process of approval for large-scale alternative energy generation projects. So large-scale is defined as anything 25 megawatts or more. For instance, the solar, I'm sorry, the turbine project up in Somerset that my town is opposed to, Somerset's opposed to, is 200 megawatts. This was designed essentially, Mr. Supervisor, to take local control out of the equation. This statute. And it's law. It is law. So what it did, it created these two, this policy coupled with the change in the law to centralize approval in Albany, I think created an environment for alternative energy companies, to say nothing of tax credits that come along with the construction of these projects, encouraged these companies to become more aggressive from the marketing perspective, because New York seems to be a friendly alternative energy state. The law, policy, the policy of 50 by 30 and the state statute creates this more inviting environment. I'm not sure that this law is going to help achieve this policy. There has not been one project yet cited in New York State by the governor's siting panel for any alternative energy project under the statute. There's a project in Casadega, New York, which is down in Chautauqua County, where everybody's in favor of it. Looks like a hot knife through butter. And that's in trouble. That project, for whatever reason, and we don't represent, we're not involved in that, but we watch it because we're involved in that industry now. And that even that project, which at least at the outset had a lot of support, public, the governmental, community support, landowner support, support from the developer, even that project is kind of stagnant. So I'm not sure that Article 10 accomplishes the goal, the policy objective. John, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is where solar begins to separate from wind. Because at least from what I've seen, as the solar companies, Cypress Creek included, are now out of the marketplace soliciting land, because at the end of the day, whether it's wind turbines or solar, you need land. There's some turbines that are being proposed off the coast of Long Island in the Long Island Sound and out in the Atlantic Ocean, but for the most part, these are land-based projects. But I haven't seen one yet, a proposed solar project that is even remotely close to 25 megawatts. Now, there might be a reason for that, but so I think, based upon what I'm seeing in the context of the lease proposals that we see in the communities that these lease proposals are cropping up in, that the solar companies don't want to employ this statewide approval process where the approval process is centered in Albany and not in Stafford. But it seems to me that because they're coming in under this 25 megawatts, that they're going to be subjected to local rules.
There is one solar project, Mohawk Solar. It's not our company, another developer in the town of Minden, I think, in the Canada area. That's a 90 megawatt proposed project that just recently submitted to the public information.
There you go.
So there's one beginning.
So there's one.
In the pipeline.
So,
but your point, most solar projects are less than 25 megawatts.
It seems that way.
Yeah.
It seems that way. Although, so my caution to the local leaders, as opposed to the local landowners, but my caution to the local leaders. So as Company X, I'm not going to pick on Cypress Creek, but as Company X comes into town, I think that everybody, whether you're you know, the municipal leaders, you know, the planning board folks, the property owners, you just need to keep this in the back of your mind, you know, because if they're trying to create the impression that they're kind of onesie twosies, you know, 2 megawatt, 3 megawatt, but from a connectivity perspective, and I'm a little bit out of my water depth now in terms of, you know, how they would be able to connect all of these into the grid without a substation, et cetera, et cetera. But I just think one of the questions, because these small onesie-twosie projects that I'm talking about are subjected to local laws. They're not subjected to Article 10, which is the state law that tries to supersede local law. Not tries, I mean, the industry claims that Article 10 does supersede your zoning ordinances. So if John was here representing Iberdrola, which is a large international wind generation company, and they had a 25 megawatt project here in Stafford, John's company's position would be your local zoning, land use, setbacks are all relevant. Because Article 10 takes that power away from you for these big projects. So I think that the projects that I've seen, or at least that I'm aware of, all on the solar side seem to be under this threshold, which then means that your local town rules, zoning, you know, noise, nuisance, all of those land use laws that are locally based and driven are applicable. I probably will come back to this. I put this number up here because, frankly, the solicitation, and I didn't bring it. If I knew you were going to be here, I would have brought the glossy solicitation that you guys sent to Vacco Farms. But in our solicitation, it was $1,500 an acre. So that's where I got this number from. I know now through this experience, and having done this 5 or 6 times through the Farm Bureau, that's not a standard number. I mean, it's number changes. I haven't seen it higher than 15, but I've seen it lower. So, you know, you know what to say about free advice. It's worth what you pay for it. But if your proposed contract that John has sent to you doesn't say 15, you ought to, you know, be negotiating around 15, because they've offered 15 to me. Okay, they've offered 15 to other landowners. My point is that this number fluctuates, but I have a proposed contract sitting on my desk back in Buffalo that says $1,500. Let's go. So what do we want to tell you about? This solar lease is, just because it has the word solar in it, and because it's part of an initiative to generate alternative energy, at the end of the day, it's still a lease. Okay, I mean, it's still a lease, so it has the same, forget about what the complications the panels bring and the maintenance of the panels, but just from a land use perspective, we're still talking about a lease. So if you have this lease, if it's shown up, in the glossy brochure that, unless they've changed it, but, you know, the one that I got, was about this size and had a nice, you know, green picture, and you know, it was very, very well presented. But at the end of the day, it's still a lease, okay? And what you want to look at as you're contemplating whether you're going to do this or not, you got to think about some of the very basics. So whether if you weren't leasing it to Cypress, but you were leasing it to Joe Smith, the dairy farmer down the street, you ought to be asking some of the same questions, all right? How long is the lease for? What's the area that the lease covers? In other words, when you sign a lease, you're giving entitlement to use your property. The lessee has a property interest now in your property. So you ought to make sure that you know exactly which portions of your property are subject to that arrangement. Better know what the limitations are on your usage now of your property because you're leasing it to somebody. But just as importantly, you need to all understand what are the limitations on the lessee's usage of the property. There are some differences, okay, which I think we get to the next slide. So some differences between the basic lease and a solar panels lease. Next slide, please. Now, some of the differences that I think you have to look out for, if you have existing land use agreements, so, you know, I mentioned you've leased your land to the bean farmer, you better look at that lease to make sure that you can lease, you can engage in the solar lease without stepping on the rights of the other lessee. But more importantly, what, you know, impact does this solar lease have on any lending obligations that you might have, like mortgages? What are the economic terms? To me, this is one of the most important things after the land use, after you're defining the land that is subject to the lease and your rights and obligations and the company's rights and obligations. How much? What are the terms? That's why, you know, I went, the first slide had $1,500 down in the corner. Now, here's where you gotta read the fine print. And John, correct me if I mistake this, but the brochure, did you bring one? The brochure.
I have a lease over on the table if you wanna pull it out.
Yeah, that's okay. But the brochure will say, it's the cover letter, you know, so let's just stick with $1,500 because that's the number on my slide, but if it's, you know, $1,000, $800, I've seen it as low as $800, but the letter will blare out to you, $1,500 an acre for, you know, 20 acres for 20 years. So you sit back and you do a little math real quick and say, 1,500 times 20, wow, that's a pretty big payoff. But then you gotta go down to the paragraph that says that there is a up to a 24 month due diligence period. And they pay you, the offer is, what is it, like $2,000 for the 24 month due diligence?
Negotiable, just like.
But in the brochure, it's, they'll pay you in increments the first 6 months, and then after the first 6 months, they'll give you another bucket of money for the next 18 months, so for a total of 24 months, that they get to do their due diligence. Well, what that means is that the lofty promise of, you know, $1,500 an acre times 20 acres for 20 years doesn't kick in until after that due diligence period is over, and they've decided that they really want your land. So, to me, this is one of the most important things that you need to take into account when you're looking at these leases, because you give them an awful lot of control over your property for 24 months for very little money. So do the math. You know, $2,000 for 20 acres, that's $10 over 20, $10 an acre over. It's $100 an acre. It's $100 an acre over a 2 year period, or $50 an acre per year. I don't know, I'm in the agriculture business. Land rent right now for good agricultural, and we pay $250 an acre. I see a gentleman nodding his head back, like he knows exactly, like he's probably paying more. But $250 an acre to rent to a farmer is not unheard of, because there's a scarcity of good agricultural land. So the $50 an acre per year is a little on the low side. And during that 20, the other nuance in that 24 month due diligence period is that you are also giving them an exclusivity. And by that, I mean that not only do they get an exclusivity on the 20 acres that they are focused on, but they get an exclusivity on all of your other acreage. So that you can't, you know, for the farm down the road that you own, You can't be negotiating with John's competitor during that due diligence period. So they're really locking you up for up to 2 years around the offer of $1,500 an acre for every acre for 20 years. But it's really, the initial period of the lease is that 24 month for $2,000. And you give up, you know, you give up some exclusivity. You get to continue to use your land, but you still give them access to your land in that period of time. We talked about identifying a specific area to be leased. I got a map that we'll use to illustrate that more a little bit later. Maintenance, repair, and cleaning responsibility. So these last two items, actually the last two items, maintenance, repair, and cleaning, and then end the term of removal obligations, are important if they built the project. Obviously, if after the 2 years, you know, company X decides that we don't want to build a project here and they walk away, better make sure that you get a release so that they're releasing you. I'm sure that they will want a release as well, but if they walk away after the due diligence period, then you have to be less concerned about maintenance, repair, and cleaning. Because this really, we put this up here, this is part of our presentation because we're thinking about when the project is built. Who's responsible for the maintenance of the panels? Who's responsible for the repair of the panels? And I know that, you know, John will say, well, certainly the industry or the company should be, but it needs to be spelled out. We're talking about your lease. Okay, I'm here not representing the industry. I'm here to represent property owners or talk to property owners. So I'm just suggesting to you that some of the things that you need to make sure you're nailed down in the lease. And oh, by the way, again, I'm trying to hit this down the middle of the fairway, but the reality is that the lease is drafted by their lawyers. So the lease that they sent to you is a company-generated lease. So, you know, how many people want to guess in whose direction the lease is tilted in favor of if it's drafted by the company's lawyers? It's been our experience that the industry will negotiate around the edges of the lease terms, but not what the industry has been, what we haven't seen for the clients that we've actually represented who have done negotiations with the industry, is that the industry will not accept our lease document. So we show up from Olympus Mathias and say, well, here's the lease that we propose. They say, no, we got to use ours. Okay? So make sure as you're reading their lease that their lawyers, that their corporate lawyers drafted, that you clearly understand who's responsible for all of these, especially the cleaning. Because this gentleman back here who's not in his head about the land use, I'm guessing that you probably got a combine and you probably bale hay, and as you're doing that, at the field that's next door to this 20-acre solar farm, and you're throwing up in the middle of July when you're baling a lot of dust, who's responsible for cleaning the panels that the dust lands on? Or you're across the street tilling acreage for planting in May, and you know it's a dry May, and you're throwing up a lot of dust when you're rolling through the field with a 180 horsepower tractor, pulling you know large disc or a rake, and the dust is blowing across the street on top of their panels. Who's responsible for cleaning them?
Mother Nature.
Well, it better say that in the lease. That's what I'm saying. It better say. So, but just as importantly then is the last item here. So when they're done, you know, look at, who would have thought, you know, 20 years ago that we could conduct our entire lives on these little things in our pockets? You know, I got the Encyclopedia Britannica right here in my pocket. You know, I could communicate across the world from the town of Stafford right here tonight. We never could have envisioned this 20 years from now. So who knows what technology and what innovation and what energy sources are going to be available 20 years from now. So when solar is obsolete, at the end of the lease term.
Or before.
Or before. Who's responsible at the end of the term for the removal? And does the lease speak to returning your property to its original state? Okay? So again, I want to make sure, I don't want John to leave here angry at me. I want to make sure that I'm trying to be fair and balanced, but I want to make sure that you understand the issues that you ought to be looking at. I'm not telling you to don't sign these leases. That's your decision. But I think that it's important for you to, especially if you're not going to be represented. So, you know, we can talk about that later, but because I'm not here tonight as your lawyer. I'm not anybody's lawyer. Nobody's paid me for this advice. That's why it's free, okay? But these are important issues to you as the property owner at the beginning and at the end of the lease. Next one, please. So we continue on. Other issues that you got to be concerned about. You know, access rights and responsibilities. You know, I don't know. I have heard that these panels sit up high enough that you could have, you know, small sized livestock like sheep graze underneath them. I think that's possible. Well, if that indeed is possible, well, that ought to be spelled out. You ought to know in your lease, you know, whether or not you can use the undercarriage, under the panels. Let's get right into, well, before we get to these two, these are easier. Let me go to the compensation for timber and crop removal. This is pretty easy. You know, this is not so much of an issue if, you know, we're talking about 20 acres of, you know, flat, nice flat land that, you know, all it has is a, you know, cover crop on it. You don't have to worry so much about crop removal or timber removal, okay? I mentioned to you early on in this presentation that I sold a permanent easement to a cell tower company. And the cell tower was like here, where this eye is, and it connected to the transmission lines out here, which is where the street is. But between here and here, all of this words is vineyard. So I wanted to know, when I sold this permanent easement, how are you going to get from here to here without going through here? Because if you're going through here, you're probably going to disrupt several acres of vineyard that are annually producing revenue for me. So if this is the path that you want to take, the path of the shortest point, from point to point, you got to pay me for it. Because I'm going to have to remove, or you're going to have to remove, revenue-generating crop, my vineyard, or a portion thereof. Well, what they decided to do, because they didn't want to rip it out, they didn't want to pay me, is that they decided to do this. They went around. And the permanent easement now, in meets and bounds, instead of the permanent easement being 3 acres around this eye, down to the lines, the easement is from here, to here, to here, to here, to the lines. So they were willing to spend more money on the front end to go around the problem. And I was happy with that, because I didn't want them to go through my vineyard. But my point is, unless you're talking to them about it, and unless you're, you know, cognizant of the fact that they want to take the point of you know, the shortest distance from point to point, it might be across, you know, might be through your woods. Well, who's going to clear the woods? Who pays? Who's the timber belong to once they've knocked it down? Again, these are the kind of simple Simon land use issues, but they need to be contemplated as you're looking at these leases. You know, limitations on the use of property. In other words, can you have any use? We've talked about that. You know, letting, you know, the sheep roam underneath the panels if that's possible. Protections against business failure. So what happens if, you know, company, you know, Solex goes under? They put the panels on your property, By the way, so let me just take this a detour here for a moment. And I'm not saying again that this is Cypress Creek's plan, but one of the things that one of the other things that's motivating these alternative energy companies at this point in time, in addition to the governor's policy and in addition to the statute, the siting statute, are tax credits. So they get tax credits for building alternative energy projects. So that's why there's so many large national and international corporations that are in this business, because they get tax credits. So they're getting a break on their taxes for building these projects on your property. Oh, by the way, you don't get the tax credit. Company gets the tax credit, you don't. Okay? But what happens after the Vacco Solar Company, who comes in and does the lease for all you people in this room, and now I put solar panels on all of these properties and I take my tax credits, but 3 years later I sell the property. I sell these leases to the Sun is Setting Company. And all of a sudden the Sun is Setting Company goes belly up, goes out of business, and you're stuck with the panels on your property. You're not getting your $1,500 an acre for each year anymore because the company's gone belly up. The lease, ought to talk about that. The lease ought to be forward thinking enough to be protecting you against business failure, especially in the event of a handoff from company A to company B. Because that's happening. That handoff is happening. I'm not saying Cypress Creek is doing it, but I'm telling you, that's part of the business model here. It is part of the business model to flip these projects once they've got the tax benefits. So now you're dealing with a company who you've never met. John seems a really, really nice guy, a likable guy. I haven't had given him a chance to say too much, but I think he's a likable guy. But if his company sells these projects, now you're dealing with somebody you've never met. And maybe he might not be so likable if you ever see that person. Again, these are not insurmountable. They are surmountable. They're resolvable, depending upon the willingness of the company to work with you on these issues. But I'm here tonight to be provocative, to give you issues that you need to think about, and you know, to take off the rose-colored glasses when you see that $1,500 an acre times 20 acres times 20 years, because there's a lot more behind it than that glossy promise. So let's go to these two right here, because this truly is, and this is not intentional. I'm not suggesting that the industry is intentionally bringing in a Trojan horse. But this is a Trojan horse. And what I mean by this, increased property taxes and loss of tax benefits. Now, for the non-farmers in the room, the second one, loss of tax benefits, is not all that important. But for the farmers in the room, like myself, whose property is subject to the agricultural exemption for property tax purposes, you're getting a break on the property taxes you pay because it's an agricultural use. You can rest assured, is the town assessor in the room, Mr. Supervisor?
No.
You can rest assured that the town assessor is going to want to increase the assessment on this property because it's gone from agricultural to industrial. I don't care how they slice it, the panels make it industrial. So before we even get to the issue of lost tax benefits, taxes on that property will go up because the assessment will go up. So one of the questions that you want to ask the company representative who comes around with the lease, who's responsible for the increase in taxes? Because if I gotta pay X amount of dollars more a year in property taxes because of your solar panels, then that $1,500 an acre doesn't look so good anymore. Because it's not net of the additional tax increase. But the real kick in the pants around this issue is for the agricultural landowners that today have a ag tax exemption, or you know the deference that is given to agricultural usage. When you make this conversion, and by the way, there's a certain time period in which you must notify the town assessor of this conversion of use. When you make this conversion, there's a 5-year look back to recoup the benefits that you received because of the ag exemption. So this is another tax on top of the go forward increased tax liability. This is a clawback by the government because you've changed the use. Who's paying for that? Is the company paying for that? Or are you paying for that? And if you're paying for that, as you're doing your economic analysis, you better take a step back and decide how much that $1,500 an acre is really worth to you as you give up control of your land for the next 20 years. These are two gigantic issues, especially if your land is subject to the agricultural tax exemption or the ag exemption. Next slide, please. Oh, finally, we get the Vacco Farms. So there you see, Cypress Creek, all right? And so I give you this illustration because, I don't know, can everybody see this? So this came with the glossy mail, right? So most of you who have received something from Cypress Creek or from some other company, they've actually gone, you know, to the county records because they know where your property is. So they've done some level of research. And this glossy was, okay, here's 20 acres. And this illustrates what I was saying earlier about location. 20 acres, you can see that most of it is wooded, all right? And then there's a little pond, and then all of a sudden, boom, so out of the 20 acres, it's probably about maybe five to seven, how nice and flat that is. Nothing out. If I'm them, I want to put my panels right here. When they say they're going to lease 20 acres, that doesn't mean they put down 20 acres of panel. They come in, the glossy brochure says, we want to lease 20 acres, but when they get done with their due diligence period, they decide, well, we don't want to knock down all of these trees. So we only want the 7 acres for the next 20 years. That's flat and easily accessible. All right, that's not a bad deal. Except this right here is my parents' house across the street. Now, of course, they don't know that when they're doing, you know, their satellite imagery or however they're getting to this point. They don't know that the neighbor is my mom and dad. But I don't know, as I've said in prior presentations, I don't know, maybe it's my mother-in-law. All right? Maybe it's my mother-in-law instead of my mom and dad. I mean, but do I really want, you know, 7 acres of glass shining on my mother-in-law's house for the next 20 years? So my point is location becomes important. And it becomes important when you're doing the lease. So that when you're doing the lease, you now can have an understanding that, look, you want my property, you want 7 acres of my property, it's going to be back here. And you're going to pay me to take the trees down, and I'm going to own the timber, but you're not putting it up here, right on the highway, right across the street from my mom and dad's house. Because I don't want them to be annoyed every day when these panels start shining the sun into their windows. And that's why this conversation needs to be had before you put your John Hancock on the lease. So they're bound now by your negotiations and the lease commitment to put the project where you want it. Not across the street from your mother-in-law's house. Okay? Next slide.
Mr. Vacco, is there gonna, you know, what about landowners that don't give a hoot about the neighbors? And then they're gonna put them on the street.
We'll get to that. You're anticipating where I'm going, but, so, this is, so just to show you, I mean, the due diligence that is already done. The last slide, you probably couldn't see it, but the last slide, go back to the last slide. The last slide says Vacco Farms Inc., New York, it's got a number, I don't recognize the number, okay? Go to the next slide. This slide says Carmine Vacco. That's my father. He happens to own this piece in his name. And that's the level of due diligence they do. So that they know that the prior piece, which is this here, so you recognize the land? That's the Vacco Farms piece, and this is Carmen Vacco's piece. I put this up here to illustrate, you know what this is? These here, and back here? Vineyards. So again, location. So if we were inclined to say, well, we'll lease you this portion, well, but I don't want to take down the vineyards, and if you're gonna pay me, you know, $2,500 an acre, when I give me $2,500 an acre and you pay to take down the vineyards and you pay me for some lost production for the next 20 years, then maybe we got a deal. You can take the vineyards down. They're never going to do that. But my point is, that's what you need to be doing on the front end of these leases. Negotiate them. Because I'm not signing a lease for this property that gives them control of 20 acres without understanding what's going to happen to my vineyard. Next slide. Again, financial impact. So now we're starting to get down to the real nitty-gritty here. All of this, you know, legal mumbo-jumbo leading up to this, but at the end of the day, it all comes down to location, 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 and, you know, price. Is it worth it to me? The value of the lease property. So, look, I do think that I said earlier in the presentation that for, you know, farmland, you know, we're paying $250 an acre to grow beans. You know, I don't know, you might think they were kind of crazy for doing that, but, you know, we're picking beans right now at a farm up in Couriers in New York, in just off of Route 16, we're paying $250 an acre for that farm because we need the land. So when you think about $1,500 an acre versus $250 an acre, if you're the property owner, you want to take the 15, right? It's a lot more. So it seems that the lease value when compared to other potential lease charges for the same property, it seems like the lease rate, even at a low $800 an acre, is a pretty good deal. But if you are in agriculture, so again, we don't own speculative land. We own land that we grow things on. I wonder, so for instance, this solar liberty, the property that they want is, you know, a really nice piece of growing land. It's 45 acres, it's as flat and as gravelly, it's just a perfect, you know, piece of land to grow beans on. So, you know, I gotta wonder if I convert this land to a solar project, you know, are we unintentionally then driving up the price for agricultural land? And that might be good for the folks that are looking to sell or who own land for speculative purposes, but it might not be so good for the farmers who then have to worry about leasing that land that is worth more, okay? So I think that these are some of the factors that you gotta think about, and then impact on non-agricultural property value. So that goes to what this young lady was talking about in the back. To the extent that you have a social conscience about your neighbors, so go back to the Vacco Farms slide, please. So, you know, let's just pretend that I don't even know who these people are. It's not my mom and dad, it's not my mother-in-law, it's just, you know, John Smith. So I don't know. just happens to live across the street from land today. You know, what obligation do I have to him? Legally, none. Legally, none. But that, as the bullet point from the third, you know, before to the slide. So as this bullet point, you know, indicates, you know, should you be thinking about the impact on the non-agricultural property values? So let's say, for instance, that that's your house across the street. You own the land where the solar panels are going to go, and you own the land across the street that's going to have the solar panels shining into your home every day. Somebody's going to have to make an analysis as to what happens to the value of that property, that residential property across the street, as a result of 20 acres of glass across the street. And you own both. So at the end of the day, net, 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 it might be, you know, you're taking out of your right pocket and putting it in your left pocket. I don't know. All I'm saying is that's part of the analysis that you need to be doing before you sign the lease. Because if you start doing this math after you've signed the lease and you find out that the math doesn't work, then you better be, you know, on your knees praying that their due diligence period causes them to walk away. Because if the math is upside down for you and you've signed the lease, your only escape clause is if they walk.
So for non-participating landowners,
they really don't have any.
They have no protections at all except to trust their town board is going to be
so
morally responsible.
Go to the next slide, please. So, and we've talked about this a little bit already. So I mentioned Article 10 early on. You know, I think, by the way, I don't think the town staff is worried about Article 10, but my law firm is the preeminent law firm in the state who represent municipalities in terms of Article 10 work. You know, there's another firm in Albany that is also an expert in Article 10, but they represent the industry. They represent, you know, several turbine companies. So if you were my client, which you're not, but I'll give you some free advice, in view of the fact that the Circus Creek guy is sitting right next to you, I mean, they're already in your town. So if you're not already conducting an analysis of your land use ordinances as it applies to the solar, I'm going to guess, Mr. Supervisor, that your ordinances were crafted at a time that the only thing you thought about when you thought about the sun was, you know, getting the sun heat. Not, you know, not heating your home, not, you know, driving electricity, like electrical power to your home. So I'm being a little facetious. I think your ordinances are probably not up to date to accommodate solar, wind, alternative energy, land use projects. And as long as these projects are coming in under the radar, so they're coming in under the 25 megawatts, so the state doesn't have the ability to snatch control from your town and take it to Albany, then to address what this woman is suggesting and other issues, so go back to my mom and dad's place. You know, I don't know, one more. You know, I mean, is setback maybe one of the considerations that you should have as an ordinance? But, you know, the issues that you're raising, the unintended consequence to the strange neighbor who you don't care about, well, they might care about it, so it falls on the town. So what I'm suggesting that you need to do, and I'm not suggesting a ban. I mean, a ban, you know, to prevent that from happening. I'm not suggesting a ban, but I'm suggesting that you take a look at your ordinances to make sure that they're, you know, up to speed, that they're kind of consistent with what's happening in the marketplace. And, you know, because the concerns of your citizens around these land use issues have evolved. They're not the same as they were 10 years ago. You know, they're certainly not the same as they were 20 years ago, let alone 40 years ago. I mean, I don't know when your code was drafted, but I bet you it's at least 25 years old. 25 years ago, nobody was talking about, you know, solar panel farms in Western New York. So you really should take a look at those ordinances to see how they can be tweaked to address some of these issues that we've raised here tonight. Whether it's, you know, neighbor setbacks, land use, you know, you have an ag district, so you want to prohibit it in the ag district so that you can, you know, preserve the agricultural nature of your community. You know, the town of Eaton in Southern Erie County, you know, they're in the business of selling development rights. They're encouraging property owners to sell development rights so that the ag land is preserved and it can't be developed. So, you know, solar, wind, housing developments, because the municipality is encouraging through the Land Conservancy to sell development rights. And Land Conservancy is a not-for-profit entity that's out there raising money regularly to help fund the process of buying this gentleman's development rights. So he gets to continue to farm his farm, and but he's paid for having given up the ability to develop it. So you might want to think about, you know, districts where you got your prime ag land that doesn't turn into a solar farm. Go back, but let me keep going, please. So we talked about this. We talked about the land conversion and the penalty on the agricultural assessment. This is a credit. So, Mr. Supervisor, this is something else that you should look at, because under state law, you can grant an exemption to the energy companies for 15 years, property tax exemption. You can do that. So far, I haven't seen a municipality, most of the municipalities I see are opting out of this.
Why would you want to do that?
Because it's an incentive to the company to come into town.
And why would you want to take care of a few farmers and have a few farmers do this?
I'm not going to make a judgment. I'm just here to be provocative to throw these issues out. But this is an issue for the municipality. You can grant, the municipality can grant this exemption.
How do they grant it? Do they have the local law?
Under state law, they have this ability. The state law is applicable right now today.
So right now today, if a community has not opted out, they're in on that.
Yes.
So you have to opt out to do something different.
Yes.
Could I add that? Yes, that exemption is currently in place, and towns have the choice to opt out of that or not. Most towns, I think, almost every town we deal with, they also have the option of entering into a payment in lieu of taxes agreement with the developer. So the town gets revenue from that, but it still maintain that tax exemption for, say, the homeowner or someone who wanted to put a small solar array together. So there is an option.
And so we're talking apples and oranges when we're talking about home solar and a solar farm, solar plant. And
we're not talking about, you know, the panels that you're putting on your roof to heat your pool.
So in lieu of this, we have a pilot. And where do we go with
that?
Payment
in lieu of taxes. That's pilot.
Why wouldn't you ask for full taxable value?
I'm sorry?
Why wouldn't a town want to get full taxable value of that project? Well, make them pay to be here.
Because, look, I don't know, maybe there's enough property owners in the town who want the benefit of the leasehold, and they want, you know, they don't want their taxes to go up. They want a moratorium for 15 years on their taxes. So, you know, it all depends on the prevailing sentiment in the municipality.
Well, shouldn't it benefit the whole town?
Well, that's why Jen is talking then about payment in lieu of taxes. So then, you know, there will be some incentive that will come from the pilot payment to the town.
Who's responsible for paying those taxes? Is the bill the responsibility of the landowner?
Well, so we covered this earlier, but yes, the property assessment is going to go up. I mean, if you got a piece of land that right now today is zone RA or RC, but I don't think you could put it on, you know, residential property. This is an industrial project. It's an industrial project. So from a zoning perspective, it either goes on RA or RC, okay? But it will increase the assessed value. It goes from, you know, kind of fallow ground or, you know, a land that has a, you know, dilapidated 25-year-old building that's not in use, and your landowner has been before the board several times to reduce the assessment on that property. When the panels go up, the assessment goes up. When the assessment goes up, the tax goes up. When the tax goes up, the landowner is responsible for the taxes under the boilerplate lease that comes from the company, which is why I said earlier, one of the negotiable items ought to be who pays the increased taxes. Okay?
Thank you. What happens if the company bellies up and out they go, but the structures still remain on the land because they're not able to clear it all up? Who pays the taxes then?
You. Property owner.
Like $86,000 or something?
Whatever it is.
So it takes 3 years to get rid of your farm.
I'm sorry?
It would take a few years to get rid of your farm because that you would have to sell to pay the taxes.
Look, I mean, this is all hypothetical. I mean, the basic question is who's responsible? The property owner is responsible, which is why early on I said that. So, look, what all of this underscores, and you know, when I get to the end of this, I'm gonna leave you with this thought. But I'll give it to you now, and I'll repeat it in a few moments. You get one of these things in the mail, and if you're inclined to entertain it, you ought to call a lawyer. Because this is not leasing your land to, you know, the dairy farmer down the street. That there's long-term ramifications that are both land use and economic. And you're starting from the point of a contract that is drafted by the company, so you have to presume that the contract is drafted in favor of the company and not necessarily in your favor. For instance, you know, if there's a dispute, choice of law. Where's the dispute litigated? It's typically in the fine print in paragraph number 98 in a contract. That says in fine print, if there's any dispute under this contract, it's going to be where company X is located in Florida. Well, if you just, you know, willy-nilly signing the boilerplate document, you've just now committed to any dispute that you have, you having to go to Florida to bring your litigation. So, what I came here to do tonight, because you asked me to, was to put out provocative questions that you need. I'm not saying that the issues that I'm raising can't be solved. They can be solved like everything else in life and business if there is a willing buyer and a willing seller. If the industry is unwilling to give you the issues that you hold most important, then you have your answer as to whether you should engage in this contract. The industry is not going to give you everything you want, but if it gives you what is most important to you, then you really should then take serious consideration of signing that lease. My point to you is that this is not something that should be done at the kitchen table. You should, because this is a multi-year, a very substantial commitment that you're making for you, your property, and your offspring, your heirs. So I'm not saying that you have to call me, but I am saying that you should call a lawyer. You have the lawyer scrutinize the lease. I think my typical advice at these events is that when you call your lawyer, whoever it is, you should have the top five most important issues that you want, you know, the gives. The five most important gives that they have to give to you. Because for this young lady in the back of the room, you know, maybe what's most important is the location of the panels so they're not right across the street from the house that she lives in. She owns the property on both sides of the road, but it's very important to her as she's into entering into this lease that she has control over where the panels are located, so they're not right on top of her home.
And it's probably hard to speculate what this, what implications it would have on property. You know, the cost of you know, property values. You know, like, how could we possibly know what kind of implications that would have, right? I mean, it's all hypothetical, right? Like, somebody puts solar panels across the street. I know when somebody puts it on their house, their property values go down and it's much harder to sell the house. So I'm thinking that that would probably be the case, you know, for neighbors. You've already mentioned that. So I just think that's an important point too, right?
It is, but I think that's, look, I think that that's more of a deal breaker point as opposed to a negotiation point, because, you know, values are speculative. I mean, how do you negotiate that into a lease?
Right.
You know, how do you build a brick wall in a lease over property values?
Right.
So to me, that's not a negotiation point. That's kind of a gut, you know, deal or no deal point.
And it affects people that aren't even in part of the lease, really. That aren't
even
the people that are negotiating.
Again, I'm not trying to push you into doing things that you don't, your town board doesn't want to do, but this is why I think that everybody in the town is better served if there's a comprehensive solar farm land use statute in the town, so that everybody has a chance to show up at the town board meetings and raise the concerns that you're raising, and then the town board evaluates it and comes up with what they think is in the best interest of all of the people in the town, and still allows the industry to come in and build a project here and there. But for you personally, because the town board isn't going to help you decide, well, look, at the end of the day, the town board is not going to help you to get out of this lease. The town board is not going to help you when you realize that the economics of the lease aren't as rosy as they looked when you got the glossy mailer in the mail. And oh, by the way, while I'm saying that, so another piece of the math that you need to do. So, you know, let me see if I can do this math off the top of my head. You're going to help me with this. So we'll do it easy, so it'll be easier for my brain. $1,000 an acre for 20 acres. Okay? That's $1,000 a year for 20 acres. That's $20,000 a year times 20 years. That's $400,000. That's $400,000 for 20 years. I just heard somebody say that's a lot. Well, but think about this for a moment. Put aside all of these tax issues that we've raised, increasing taxes, the loss of the farm aid exemption, you know, all of the questions about who's going to clean the panels when the farmer, you know, blows dust on it. Let's compare the $400,000 in income, because that's what it is. It's income. And you've lost land for 20 years.
And control.
You've lost land for 20 years for $400,000 over 20 years.
Which,
by the way,
people here will be dead.
By the way, Just for easy math, let's say that everybody in this room is in a 25% tax bracket. So over the 20 years, that means that you will pay $100,000 in just income tax. So we're not talking about the property tax increase. We're not talking about the loss of the assessment. We're just talking about what you're going to pay on the income. So $400,000 on December 1st of 2017, over 20 years, will cost you $100,000, netting you $300,000 versus on December 1st, 2017, you sell the same piece of land for $400,000. Now, the math's not going to work because I made the tax rate so low because the capital gains rate is 25%. So if your tax bracket is only 25%, your cap gains, because your cap gains is 20 on the federal side and 5 on the state side for a combined 25%. So you're going to pay the same $100,000 as if your property, your income tax bracket was 25. But every point of a percent above 25 that your income tax bracket is, so let's say your income tax bracket is 30%, that $400,000 is now really worth only $280,000. Because the tax is $120,000 over 20 years. Whereas you can sell the property, pay the capital gains on it, and walk away with $300 today.
Yes, and have it.
So it's then you get the present day value of cash. So again, I'm not trying to talk anybody into or out of this. All I'm saying is that there is a plethora of issues that are personal to everyone in the room. So this analysis of the tax bracket, I don't know, you look like you're very successful. Your tax bracket is probably 39%. You're probably at the highest end of the tax bracket. So this analysis that I'm giving to you is, you know, even more substantial to you than it is to me. Okay? So these issues sometimes are specific to each individual. My basic point is that whether it's, you know, these issues that we're talking about, taxes, land use, community values, you need to take a step back when you get that brochure and sit down and talk to your lawyer, get out the pencil and crunch the numbers and figure out if after everything is taken into consideration, what they're willing to give and what you're willing to give in negotiations to sign that lease, whether it's worth it to you. Yes, sir.
You mentioned the $1,000 figure now. Earlier you had $1,500 figure.
Yeah.
Earlier somebody, I believe you and the Cypress print man, were talking about possibly selling to another company in 3 or 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to pay that full $15?
Well, that's why I put up there on the board one of the risks here.
Well, can they go?
No, they can't. So anybody who's buying the company, what they would be selling. So let's take it out of John's hands.
Right, right.
Let's talk about Terry Pegula. Okay? You know that guy who owns the Buffalo Sabres and the Buffalo Bills?
He's the fracking guy.
The fracking guy. But this is a good example. Because what did Terry Pegula sell?
Right.
Terry Pegula sold land leases. Terry Pegula had a bunch of Johns that were knocking on doors in Pennsylvania, signing up property owners to leases. Terry Pegula didn't sell thousands of wells. He sold tens of thousands of acres. Your acres, my acres, in the form of leases. The same thing can happen here. They cobble together all of these leases, and then they sell the leases. The good news is that the entity that acquires the leases are still subject to the terms of the leases. So your question, you know, what happens to the $1,500 an acre? They buy it subject to the terms of the leases. But my point to you is that you now have a partner that you didn't intend, that you didn't know, that you didn't cut the deal with. And all of a sudden, today, tomorrow, that partner goes belly up, and now you're stuck with $0 an acre, and you're stuck with the panels on the land. That's why the contract, the lease, so let's call it for what it is. It's a contract. The contract needs to be that specific. So what happens to the liability in the event they sell the lease, and the successor in interest doesn't fulfill the terms of the lease? Who's on the hook for that? Now, I know that they're never going to cave in and say that they'll absorb the liability, that they'll indemnify you for that. Okay? But you should ask for it. And if when they tell you no, that we're not going to indemnify you for our successors in interest, then you have some math to do. But my point is that these are the questions and issues that need to be raised, that must be raised, before you ink the lease.
If I can add to that, most every town either in their solar code or as a condition of their approval for a solar project requires a decommissioning plan and financial assurance to that decommissioning plan that ensures if a company walked away from it that the town would have access to money to properly remove for those panels. So as a landowner, I would encourage the town to hold the developer to that in their approval process.
That's a very good response, and I endorse that response, except what he's talking about doesn't cover the payment obligations under the lease.
And,
it just covers, it's a bond that covers the removal.
2 weeks ago we
But
had,
not the lease terms.
2 weeks ago we had a gentleman in the back of the room, does anyone remember that was there, that said he didn't remember, he was something to do with the Batavia solar farms that are being created, and he was quite gung-ho about the leases and so on, but he didn't know anything about the decommissioning. He didn't remember anything about the decommissioning and he couldn't speak to it, and it appeared that that would have been, I think that's a very salient question when dealing with this, and I don't think it was fully discussed in Batavia, but I don't know the answer to that question. I just know that he was very involved in this, in the leasing, and in the putting forth the, or conducting the solar farm, but he didn't know about the decommissioning. And he was asked several times about it, so I just, I'm not sure that it always gets worked
through.
They had
a bond, he said they had a bond, I guess.
But he didn't know anything more about it than that.
I don't know if the solar company,
yeah,
bond or the town.
But I think what John is saying is that some towns are requiring that bond.
They require, it could be a bond or a letter of credit or cash or some financial instrument that guarantees if the company goes away, there's money there for the town.
It's
written in the lease, it was responsible to put up that bond.
Well, that's not written into the lease. It could be, I suppose, but it's either written into the town's code or it's a condition that of approval that the town puts upon the developer so that they have to post that bond or that assurance mechanism prior to beginning construction.
So are you saying that the town would do that part instead of with the lease itself?
Well,
I'm saying, the point I'm making is towns require that of us, and if that makes anyone feel better, I don't know.
So removal and turn that into the agriculture
use. The New York State University.
Restore to its original.
That they have a sample code, that decommissioning and then having that bond or a line of escrow account, are there suggestions?
Yeah, but that's just a suggestion. That's what John is suggesting is that the municipality needs to make that a requirement.
Absolutely.
Should a landowner, before they do it, do like a land separation and sell the long wall street or something, to have that portion of land removed from what they all of the rest of the land they own in case there's problems down the road?
So that's an interesting point. It doesn't change the tax liability. All it changes is, you know, any liability that would arise from the solar farm.
I could see a neighbor pursuing some kind of a lawsuit against them for devaluing their property or whatnot.
Yeah, so by separating the property into a separate LLC, conceivably you're exposing only that asset to a lawsuit.
But you're still an owner. You're still the owner.
Yeah, but
my other question, and I've answered with other speakers we've had, why are these companies not coming in and offering to purchase my land versus a lease?
That's their business decision.
You should ask them.
Will some of the companies?
I mean, just so the example that we did over here, I think is illustrative of that. So they can control your land, they can control your 20 acres for the next 20 years, for only $20,000 a year versus controlling it in perpetuity for an upfront payment of $400,000. It's just economically, it makes more sense for them to spread that out over 20 years. And that's part of their sales pitch as well, that because at the end of the lease, you get your land back. So you've made all of this money and you get your land back.
Okay.
anywhere from 2 to 5%, the panels lose their ability to produce electricity. So, I mean, if it was max, I mean, in 10 years, it's 50%. They're not going to continue to pay $1,500. I mean, they're going to, what would they do then? Get another company to buy it to fold? I mean, if it's not
protected. I don't know what the longevity of the panels are.
And the state isn't going to keep subsidizing something that's not.
No, actually, at least for wind, the tax credit is starting to dissipate.
It is for solar, too.
So the window is closing.
But you can bet the lobbyists are working hard right now.
Actually, the question about the land ownership. You mentioned what happens if the company sells the lease or goes out of business. What if the landowner needs to sell their farm, or the owner passes and there's something
the lease goes with it?
That's why, you know, I mentioned early on that, you know, the component of this, because of the potential duration of the contract, is an estate planning device or plan. But as this gentleman correctly points out, you sell the land subject to the lease. So if you sell the land, you've got to sell it subject to the terms of that lease, which conceivably has an impact on the value of the land that you're selling, because you're selling, you know, the owner is only going to benefit from that land to the extent that the lease gives him a benefit until the lease is over. So you're kind of, you know, you got to find somebody that's going to buy it because they want that solar lease, that solar panel lease, because they're not buying that land for any other use while that lease is in effect.
As an attorney, let's assume that the town excludes a certain amount of the agricultural land from putting solar panels on it because of the level of the value of the property as farmland. But let's assume you do that. Now we have someone who owns some of this property. And do they have the ability to sue the town? Because we excluded their property.
But there's a whole process. You just don't show up one night at your board meeting and you know, pass this ordinance. If you did that, you'll be sued. Okay? But there's a process. The process goes probably all the way back to the comprehensive plan. You know, the town's comprehensive plan. You know, we're doing this up in the town of Clayton right now with your counterpart, you know, Dave Strand, who's the supervisor up in Clayton. Because, you know, he wanted to put the toothpaste back in the tube after the wind company showed up. We encouraged him to go all the way back to the drawing board to the comprehensive plan, so that there's, you know, an analysis of the comprehensive plan. In other words, if your determinations about land restrictions are rational and there's been due process around it, and everybody in the rooms had a chance to have input, and for those that didn't show up to the hearings, you know, at least they were notified about the hearings. If the more process that you have in getting to that ordinance, the more insulated the municipality is against an attack on it. So in Clayton, we're right back, and it's taken us, you know, we're not done yet. And we're going to end up with what we think is some bulletproof statute ordinances that will exclude the wind industry from certain portions of the town. But I'm pretty comfortable with the bulletproof nature of it, because we've sent the town all the way back to the point of the beginning.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work, it's a lot of committee time, a lot of public hearings, but that's how you make it bulletproof.
Could I ask if you're thinking about soil?
Soil type.
Yeah. Is that what you're thinking about?
Well, but what he's talking about is an ordinance that restricts, you know, certain property based upon soil type.
Yeah. And the
you just can't do that. You just can't show up one night and, you know, vote 5-0 to do that.
That wouldn't be constitutional. What about, you mentioned the 5-year picking up, if you've taken an egg exemption on your taxes, it goes back 5 years. Suppose if somebody just buys it within the last 2 years, but they have to go back, who's going to make up those back taxes?
Well, those back taxes are owed at the time of the conversion. So, and how the tax, how the penalty is calculated, so they take the benefit that you've got. So let's say you got $100 per acre benefit. So, you know, it's $2,000 a year in benefit that you got under the ag exemption, and you got that for the last 5 years, you owe the municipality $10,000.
Who tells the farmer that he's got that 5-year look back?
That's why I'm here.
That's a surprise. Well, those guys aren't here tonight.
But the only advice that I want you to follow tonight is get a lawyer. I've called this the Trojan horse. I'm not saying it's intentional, but it is the Trojan horse. This is a negative aspect of this that just kind of rolls into your kitchen and nobody knows it's there.
Back to the mother-in-law department.
Yeah.
I was going to promise you this would be my last comment of the night. How serious is that, Sunday? I mean, if the town or any town allowed one to be built, would that glare go into a highway or something and affect traffic?
Well, can I answer that? First of all, I just want to say all his advice is excellent tonight. It really is. But with respect to glare, it's not shiny glass. First of all, the panels are built to absorb sunlight and they have a non-reflective coating on it. And so you're not going to get some kind of reflection or glare. But with if our company were ever to submit an application to the town, I hope you would expect us to submit a glare analysis, which we would do, which would demonstrate that that fact.
Okay.
Do they rotate?
Solar panels are put on airports and along runways, so the FAA is assured that there's no glare.
John, do they rotate to follow us on?
They can. Most of our, probably every project we'll build in New York State is a fixed tilt. It's about a 25-degree angle towards it. But there are, if you're very land constrained or you just have a lot of sun and you're couching out in the west, you
know, so
a panel that moves the track and attract the sun to get some more generation out of it. Yeah.
Dennis, I would like to ask a 7.5-acre solar field in my town. So I tried this out because I know glass absorbs light. So I wanted to see, is there any problem? So I went over at night and drove along the side of the field, and I couldn't believe the amount of glare coming back at me from the metal infrastructure that they're encased in. So the glare may not come off of perhaps the panels, but they sure do come off of the steel or aluminum. So I would ask, why not take that black? And the answer came back, because it affects the amount of heat energy that's generated with the panels, so they're not going to paint those black. So there is reflection, so setbacks from roads are important, because it bothered me driving.
Okay, one last, I'm running out of steam here, so.
I've been following the renewable energy issue for probably close to 15 years, and so Ivanpah Solar, right, it's a huge solar facility, and there are articles you can find online about how the pilots flying above can see, are distracted by the glare of the solar factory below. But just an FYI for everybody in here, because I have been following it, in 2000, New York State was getting 19% from hydro. We were, to sum it up, we were already getting about 50% of our electricity from emissions-free sources in 2000. It was 19 from hydro, 29 from nuclear, and 1% from all other renewables. After hundreds of billions of dollars going into it, We're now at 23% from hydro, 30% from nuclear, and 3% from all other, which is wind, solar, biofuels, wood, everything else. So hundreds of billions of dollars over almost 20 years, and we've only gotten to 3% from all other renewables. They don't count nuclear towards their goal. So
that's because they're closing nuclear.
Well,
the governor has closed the nuclear power plant.
This plan is going to cause total chaos in New York State. If we have a freaking cold winter like we did, and they shut down all the nuclear and all the coal, you better pack your bags and get out of New York State. That's all I'm telling you. Because wind and solar are illusionary. They're going to go away as soon as the tax credits dry up, and you people are going to be left holding the bag. It's a total ripoff.
So, I said when I started this that I was going to be objective. Okay? And I've tried to be objective.
You are.
The points that you have raised go more to the policies than to these leases.
So wind and solar provide no firm capacity. They do not provide reliable, dispatchable baseload power. They cannot replace conventional sources that do.
I'm not here tonight to debate policy.
I know you're not. Okay? I want people to know.
So now you're starting to look familiar to me.
Because I showed up at a place up in Somerset because of the wind mess.
See, so I just said that. So you probably heard me say in the driving rain last year the park up there on the lake, right on the lake? Golden Hill. Were you there that day that it was pouring?
No, I stayed home.
Cats and dogs? Well,
I was at the lighthouse meeting.
Okay, I was there too.
Yeah.
So I did not say this at the lighthouse meeting. So this, I'm just going to comment now on the policy. So you know that you'll understand that you and I are aligned on the policy, which is distinguishable from the leases.
Right.
Okay. So I can be, as a lawyer, I can be agnostic or objective about the leases and still be opposed to the policy. But I said that day in the driving rainstorm, as the former Attorney General of the state, so I get it as well as anybody does, you know, the fact, you heard me say at the beginning that 50 by 30 is an illusion. It is an illusion, and you've just proven it. Your statistics have proven it. But the more disturbing part about this, from my perspective, is that, in my exact words that day, is that at least, so the policy represents a massive upstate land grab.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The policy represents a massive upstate land grant.
And because I've been following the wind issue for 15 years, I can tell you these companies will say something in their lease, and I have seen it time and again, where they do not abide by what you think you agreed to. Time and again, broken drain tiles, not repaired. Site and access roads and the lines, wherever they want, not where they told you they were going to be, and then you have no recourse. They have taken control of your land.
And in Article 10 is what's driving that process now, because it's taking control away from you, because it's taking the voice from your local representatives out of the equation. So you have no more voice. So if this were a wind presentation, I would have up there on the screen the five people who are on the siting panel. And they're all Cuomo appointees. They're all his commissioners. So if at the end of the day, they're analyzing a project in the town of Somerset, do they really care what Dan Engert and his constituents think, because they gotta drive the governor's 50 by 30 policy?
Because they're getting their pockets lined by the big corporations.
Well,
let's be real.
I'll keep it at the fact that the local control is lost. I've given you my political statement. Article 10 and the 50 by 30 represents a massive upstate land grab. There's not a single project that looks anything like the one in Somerset, anywhere remotely close to New York City. As a matter of fact, the governor closed Indian Point Nuclear Power Plant, which is a setback to his 50 by 30 policy. And you just cited the statistics. So shutting down nuclear, because you know the green energy people don't consider nuclear to be green, it makes the necessity of upstate alternative wind and solar all the more important to get to the policy objectives.
But then one last comment, and I'll leave you alone because I can talk about this for hours. The thing that really drives me crazy sometimes is people that think wind and solar is the answer. They don't even know the difference between energy and power, number one. You need to buy Robert Bryce's good book, Power Hungry, and he has a new one, smaller, denser, faster, lighter, cheaper. But
you'd be happy to know that I spoke with Robert at the Manhattan Institute last fall.
But the point I was going to make is people are fighting against fossil fuels, thinking they're bad. Without fossil fuels, this country wouldn't be what it is. And number two is wind does not stand alone by itself on the grid. It's paired with natural gas. The more wind you put in, the more gas you're going to need. So all these people that have been fighting fracking are and supporting wind do not understand that they are pushing to have more natural gas. That's what has replaced coal in New York State, is natural gas. We are get 40% of our electricity in New York State from natural gas now. Coal is 1%.
The coal generation facility in Somerset is shut down.
It's shutting down.
That's part of the plan too. There goes all those jobs, all the tax base. I live in Wyoming County. There's 308 wind turbines and there's no jobs, people.
Actually, but Mr. Supervisor, there's actually there's a solar project that's being proposed for that property now.
Well, they have all the switchgear and the transmission lines are there.
Yeah. However, what is the production versus what was there?
There won't be any jobs there. The tax base will be minuscule from what it was. And what they'll end up having to do if they want to have lights that turn on in the wintertime is turn that plant to natural gas.
Well, okay, I'm going to go. we're way beyond the leases and...
Sorry.
Don't be sorry.
Not really.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Let me leave you with this commercial. I've made an offer at the Farm Bureau meetings that for flat fee of $1,000, we will review your lease. We will review your lease and engage in the negotiation for your five must-haves. So I call them the must-haves. For $1,000 flat fee, Joe Hines would lead the effort. So if you can find another lawyer who could do it cheaper than that, go and get them, but you need a lawyer to do this work.
Thank you very much.
I do. What's your name? Hey, how are you?